There are two things you can be absolutely sure about: death and taxes. And one of these can't be delayed. That's right, taxes. The other, death, can be delayed through living healthy and spending money the tax man didn't taketh. Healthcare is probably the most compelling investment thesis there is, and it's where AI stands to add a lot of value. Today, we're going to talk about an AI stock that stands to transform the healthcare system. Or does it? An amazing disruptive growth thesis is expected, so let's touch on that briefly. I like this sample Venn diagram here because lots of times companies try to use Venn diagrams to depict their business models and don't do it very successfully. Well, when you look at this Venn diagram from Tempus AI, it rather makes sense. So you have genomics tests there at the top. They provide data. That data goes into this growing data repository, and it's then targeted by AI algorithms that help discern the data and help make the genomics tests better. So it's all this big loop that just results in things getting better and better over time. But it's important to note that that data set isn't just coming from the genetic tests that Tempus AI offers. Now, as with any AI company, the ground truth is always in revenue growth. And here we've depicted the growth for the two primary segments of Tempus AI, genetics testing and their data and services segment. You can see strong growth in both, whilst data and services intuitively has stronger gross margins. So that's the more profitable segment. We'll want to see more growth there as time goes on. Now we see 24% growth last year in terms of test volume, but the immediate question is, well, what are these tests actually comprised of? What are they testing? And what we can do is look at this piece we did on the massive cancer blood test opportunity. This is quite a good read. And in this piece, we showed this great diagram from Gardant, and I think it separates cancer blood tests into three categories. So you have initial screening to determine if you have cancer. That's probably the biggest opportunity of the three. Then you have recurrence. So these are sort of out of order. Recurrence would be seeing that when you have therapies for cancer patients that they're actually getting rid of the cancer, and if it comes back, that would be recurrence. Then you have therapy selection. So identifying the type of unique cancer that an individual has and choosing an appropriate therapy. So Gardant is trying to target all three of these areas. You have other firms that are targeting areas as well. So Grail's looking at screening, things like that. But what we can then do is look to see, well, what areas would Tempus AI be targeting? And we looked at Tempus quite a while ago, back in 2020. And then more recently, when they had their IPO, we did a video on them. And then this recent piece here, Tempus AI stock is the hype merited. I strongly recommend that you read that piece because it details the sort of tests they're doing. And the key takeaways would be, I think, firstly, their Ambry genetics acquisition. So that's going to accelerate their path to profitability, also increase revenue significantly. It adds about 400,000 germline hereditary disease tests. So basically, when you're going to have a child, you can then test that child for hereditary diseases and then act accordingly at later stages of the infant's life. So this expands the Tempus AI focus outside of just oncology, though. In analyzing all their collateral, you get the feeling that it is primarily just oncology at the moment. Now, there's one thing we noted that perhaps takes a little digging to find out, but there's a lawsuit that's been leveled at Tempus by Gardant, and it's rather nasty. There's a potential of a large liability there, along with future royalties that could eat into those genetics testing gross margins. We also have some concerns around profitability. I think that just comes down to whether they're going to have to raise more capital by issuing more shares or issuing more debt. They already have some debt that we look at in this piece. Now, they're expecting, especially with the acquisition of Ambry Genetics, EBITDA profitability to be accelerated, and they'll arrive at that this year, whatever EBITDA profitability means. Our recent piece on Warren Buffett's annual report looks at the ways that EBITDA can be used incorrectly. That's why we mainly look at operating cash flows. So we want to see positive operating cash flows. That means the business is generating money. They don't have to go raise it. But that's rather difficult to discern because they're quite volatile. So today we want to mainly look at the AI in Tempus AI, which is that data and services component. And this diagram here describes their data set. They talk about having one of the largest proprietary data sets in the world. We want to look at that a little bit deeper. They talk about being connected to 65% of all academic medical centers, greater than 50% of the oncologists in the U.S. They talk about 240 petabytes of data. So when we think about the competition for Tempus AI, again, going back to those two segments in genomics, we really want to hone in on Guardant. That happens to be a company we're holding. We've done that in that piece, and you can read all about that. But when it comes to the data and services segment, there's three firms they list here. The first, Flatiron, they were acquired by Roche in 2018 for $1.9 billion. Then you have IQVIA. They're a company we like, actually. We've covered them before. And then you have Concert AI. And what's rather interesting about Concert is look at this press release from Guardant. This is just a month ago. Guardant and Concert to collaborate and form data as a service that integrates the tumor profiling data that Guardant has produced with the 5.5 million clinical records that Concert AI has. So you contrast that with the 9 million records that Tempus AI has. But it isn't really a numbers game, and I'll show you why. So here's a look at IQVIA's data. You see they have 1.2 billion patient records. Oh, you contrast that with 9 million. It's wow, they have exponentially more data than their competitors, Tempus and Concert AI. But when you start to look at size of the data, then you see that, well, they only have 64 petabytes versus the 250 petabytes that Tempus has. And what this implies is that IQVIA has breadth, whilst Tempus AI and Concert AI have depth. Now, if we were going to invest in Tempus, we'd want to contrast that clearly with IQVIA. They're a contract research organization. So basically, they help pharma companies bring drugs to market in the simplest form. And what's interesting is when you look at the top contract research organizations, or they call them CROs in the world, there's IQVIA in the top. This is based on revenues. But when we look closer at IQVIA's revenue growth, what we see here is just some real stagnation over the past 3 years. And they're predicting 3% revenue growth for this year. That's not very impressive at all. And look at these gross margins. So the good news is that they're consistent. The bad news is that they're consistently below 35%. Well, that's probably because they're a services organization, not just about data. So their margins aren't going to be as juicy as a company that just licenses data like Tempus AI does. So getting back to the size of the data set that Tempus AI has. So they say here, well, our database is more than 50 times the size of the Cancer Genome Atlas. This is the key word here, the largest public genomic data set we know of in oncology. Well, there's also lots of private data sets. So the takeaway here is that when you look at this public data set, okay, it has 11,000 patient records. That's not very many compared to the millions that Tempus and Concert have. But these records compare normal tissue to cancer tissue. And what they're able to then do is glean lots of useful information. There's some examples of that here, and you can see revolutionary findings coming out of this small data set, such as revealing that stomach cancer isn't a single disease, but a disease with four subtypes, or that breast cancer and ovarian cancer have similarities that weren't known before. So just some findings so far. I think the IQVIA data represents breadth and the Tempus AI data represents depth, but really the threat from IQVIA is unknown. Tempus AI talks about dabbling in other diseases, but they seem primarily to be involved in oncology, though their acquisition of Ambry Genetics is said to help them break into other areas, because if you're testing at the germline for hereditary diseases, that goes well beyond just cancer. Now, size of data sets doesn't matter. Are companies willing to pay for the data? And this is a great slide. So if you dig into the SEC filings for companies, you can find a lot of useful information. And here's some of it for Tempus AI. This is their data and services segment broken down into three areas. So you have insights. This is where they've de-identified all that data and they're letting pharma companies access it. You can see the growth. So last year that grew from $117 million to $187 million. And you can see that makes up the majority of the data and services segment. They also have this trial matching tool. I don't know really how much that uses AI. I mean, sort of could be done with a traditional software, I suppose. But the concern there is that they actually saw a decline in that sub-segment's revenues for 2024. I didn't see any commentary around that. Perhaps there's some earnings call that contains that information. But when it comes to AI, we see this grand growth. Well, always when a company talks about growing revenues 300%, look at the baseline, right? So they're starting out at a very small baseline. No, they're up to $12.4 million. So above $10 million is what we would start to consider meaningful. But we want to mainly focus on the insights segment. So they talk about working with 19 of the 20 largest pharmaceutical companies. So they've captured most of the big players. The question is, what's the maximum these firms are going to spend with Tempus AI? That's sort of your ceiling until Tempus expands their data set. Now, they say these customers either pay on a per-file basis or through multi-year data licensing agreements, and they provide this net revenue retention metric of 140%. That's very useful to watch. What that means is these companies that started out at the beginning of the year are increased their spend by 40%. So they're finding usefulness in the data set. And what that will signal is when that number starts going down, it means, well, companies aren't finding any more usefulness in that data set that merits paying Tempus AI more money. So you want to pay attention to that. Now, when it comes to AI algo, some interesting comments. They talk about more than 80,000 molecular oncology algos having been ordered, though they don't bill separately for them. That's interesting. So they're really a feature, and that perhaps helps them distinguish their tests from competitors. They also talk about robotics being used to help them offer cheaper tests than competitors. So if you can offer something that's cheaper with better functionality, clearly you will have more customers as a result. They talk about algos, most of them being offered as part of this XR assay here, which I've listed out. And they also, interestingly enough, talk about solid tumor profiles and how 10% of them are using this tumor origin test. Now, I think this was 5 or 6 years ago. I was invited down to the Stanford campus to attend a medical imaging seminar. And one of the presenters caught my eye. It was this gentleman from Arterys, and he was talking about how when you take medical images, so MRIs, 80% of the data captured can't be used, the metadata. Well, he had developed algorithms that let you use a lot of that data that previously couldn't be used. So essentially, you're able to capture a lot more value through medical images that could have already been taken, and they were acquired in 2022 by Tempus AI. So I thought that was rather interesting. Another thing to note, because I know people will bring it up, is that ARC, I think, is quite bullish on Tempus AI. So I think it's their ninth largest position in their flagship ETF right now. Every time you see ARC's trade alert, seems like they're adding Tempus AI. And they had the founder here on their podcast. And that's one thing about ARC, I think, that we wouldn't do is talk to company leaders. So we get approached quite often by PR firms saying, do you want to interview this person or that person? I think it was D-Local recently. And we're quite curious about D-Local, but we're not going to sit down and talk to a media trained individual who's just going to parrot what they say in the earnings calls and press releases. You're not going to glean anything useful. If anything, these are glorified salespeople lots of times, and you'll find yourself starting to buy a lot of the bullshit, right? And maybe what they're saying isn't, but certainly, I don't find much usefulness in that. So for what it's worth, ARC is certainly bullish about Tempus AI, and you can see why. It's a very compelling business model. Now, just some parting thoughts. What's the revenue ceiling on their current data set? Is this a stable run rate over time, or do pharma companies use it and then they're all done with it? I don't think that's the case. It probably has a stable run rate, but what is that? How can Tempus AI expand that data set without having to acquire more companies? Are they going to see positive operating cash flows in 2025? That would be great. Shares right now are extremely volatile because the astrology for men people are spouting lots of nonsense. So be careful about that. Set a simple valuation ratio target. We talk about that in our article, specifically what that is. I think the overlap with Guardant Health, since we're already holding Guardant, I think that's acceptable. It's actually rather interesting. It's a sort of a hedge, actually. And there's certainly some there to Tempus AI. And if we decide to take a position in the company, our premium subscribers will be the first to know. By the way, they were the sole reason that this video was produced. So I'm going to go ahead and leave you with this piece we did on the best performing healthcare stock ever, which we happen to be holding. Give that a watch next. Thanks so much for taking the time to watch this today.